The International Energy Agency has identified three areas of energy use that they regard as blind spots for international governments and policymakers. We looked at petrochemicals a couple of weeks ago. The second area is heavy goods vehicles and trucks, which we'll focus on in a future programme. But perhaps the scariest of the three is the rapidly growing demand for cooling across many parts of the world. The irony is that as our world gets warmer, the market for air conditioning expands. Between 1990 and 2016, sales of AC units have quadrupled from 33 million to 135 million per year. There are now more than 1.6 billion air conditioners in use around the world, and more than half of them are in just two countries, the People's Republic of China and, of course, the good old US of A. But the rest of the developing nations are catching up fast. All that electrically powered cooling inevitably increases energy use, which in most countries is still met by fossil fuels. And that means more CO2 up in the atmosphere and even higher temperatures, which in turn means even more demand for air conditioners. So just when you thought we had big enough problems with multiple temperature feedback loops up in the Arctic, turns out we humans have managed to develop another very effective one all on our own. And the 2020 pandemic looks set to reduce investment in building energy efficiency measures by more than 10%. So what exactly does the International Energy Agency suggest the future looks like for the climate and the global cooling industry? Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. In July 2020, the IEA published this report, which builds on their 2018 Future of Cooling analysis. The report tells us that the use of air conditioners and electric cooling fans accounts for nearly 20% of the total electricity used in buildings around the world today. And it's a trend that will continue going upwards as the world's economic and demographic growth increases in the hotter countries. We do need cooling, of course. In fact, the UN says that effective cooling contributes towards achieving almost all of the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And it's not just domestic air conditioners either. Mobile cooling in private vehicles and on public transport is becoming increasingly essential too. We also need industrial and commercial refrigeration to keep pharmaceuticals like vaccines viable, and to ensure that fresh food is kept at the right temperature at every step of the cold chain, from harvesting all the way to supermarket shelves or restaurant tables. And of course, we also need to keep our working environments at reasonable temperatures so that human beings in workforces can remain productive. All in all, there are an estimated 3.6 billion cooling appliances in use globally today, and that number is growing by about 10 devices every second. It's a staggering rate of growth, which carries a double whammy of climate impact. Most of us know that air cooling devices are very energy hungry. That's the first problem. But on top of that, the gases they use in their refrigeration pipes are hydrofluorocarbons, or HFCs, and HFCs are extremely potent greenhouse gases. That's not a massive problem while they're safely captured in a closed-loop system during operation, but a significant amount of leakage occurs when new units are installed and gassed up, as well as during any repairs or maintenance on the system, and of course at the end of life of a system if it's not correctly disposed of. About 30 years ago, the world enacted the Montreal Protocol, which is widely acknowledged as the world's most successful environmental treaty. It solved the first great threat to the global atmosphere by banning the chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs, that were destroying the ozone layer. It's reckoned that this one piece of coordinated action alone has avoided a level of atmospheric warming equivalent to the amount we've caused by all our CO2 emissions. In other words, without that action, the world would already be 2 degrees Celsius warmer than pre-industrial levels. It helped that the hole in the ozone layer was so bloody obvious that no sane-minded policymaker could pretend it wasn't there in the way that some of them do with climate change today. But nevertheless, it showed that globally coordinated action is possible. The latest addition to the Montreal Protocol is now specifically targeting HFCs. It's called the Kigali Amendment, and it's been in force since 2019. HFCs don't affect the ozone layer, which is why they replace CFCs in the first place. But as I mentioned earlier, they're still a very potent greenhouse gas. Replacing HFCs with climate-friendly refrigerants and improving the efficiency of cooling equipment will avoid the equivalent of about 260 billion tonnes of CO2 emissions by 2050, say the IEA, saving nearly $3 trillion in energy generation and transmission costs, and avoiding 0.5 degrees Celsius of warming by the end of the century. One potential replacement for HFCs is a refrigerant class known as hydrofluoroolefins, or HFOs. The scientific explanation of how HFOs differ from HFCs is outside the scope of this video, but here's why the difference matters. The global refrigeration, air conditioning and heat pump market, known as RACHP, categorizes refrigerants according to their global warming potential, or GWP, on a sliding scale of severity from 1 to more than 20,000. The calibration gas is carbon dioxide with a GWP of 1. You can see that methane and nitrous oxide, gram for gram, are far more impactful to atmospheric warming than CO2. But check out HFCs, absolute nightmare. According to the United Nations Emission Programme, the weighted GWP average for HFCs is 2,200, and the most widely used HFC refrigerant, HFC-134A, has a GWP of 1,360. In stark contrast, HFOs have a GWP in the low single digits. This chart from the IEA report shows the commonly used gases in the various industries along with their GWP values compared to the recommended alternatives, including several HFOs. Many people argue that we should be reducing the overall demand for refrigerant gases and perhaps even reducing the requirement for refrigerant-based cooling systems in the first place. So how do we do that? Well, much better design, manufacturing and servicing of cooling systems is a must, but recovering and reclaiming refrigerants from products that have reached the end of their life will also be crucial. There's currently very little funding or incentive to deal with obsolete kit responsibly. The result of that is a constant danger of leakage from storage tanks and discarded equipment. There are also alternative cooling systems that don't involve the compression of gas, the so-called not-in-kind cooling systems, including something called magnetocaloric refrigeration, which leverages a phenomenon called the magnetocaloric effect, in which a suitable material heats up when subjected to a magnetic field and then cools down again when it's removed from it, chilling a secondary glycol fluid that can then be circulated through the cooling system. That's a development that's already gaining traction in commercial and medical refrigeration. Another alternative is absorption cooling, which takes excess heat from industry or wastewater treatment plants and through a series of quite convoluted steps involving heat exchangers, evaporators and condensers, causes an ammonia water solution to absorb heat from an air-conditioned space in a closed-loop cycle. Then there's district cooling, like this system in Paris, operated by a company called ClimeSpace, with a total cooling capacity of 285 megawatts. The system takes water from the River Seine and chills it to an average temperature of 5 degrees Celsius through 71 kilometers of pipelines, supplying 5 million square meters of space in hotels, offices, government buildings, theaters, and museums. The cold water and ice are produced during the night, reducing the need for chiller capacity during peak demand hours and lowering operating costs via cheaper nighttime electricity and colder ambient nighttime temperatures. Evaporative cooling is another promising possibility for cooling buildings. This could come from a body of water next to the building or a water spray over the roof, or it could be direct evaporative cooling, drawing hot, dry air through a continually dampened pad and supplying cool, humid air inside the building through the process of evaporation, in just the same way that evaporating water or sweat draws heat from our overheated skin during exercise. Some of these systems can use as little as 10% of the energy required by conventional chillers. If humidity is a problem, then indirect evaporative cooling can be achieved by using a heat exchanger to cool the supply air. It's not as efficient as direct cooling, but the ambient air remains drier. Most of these solutions will have their biggest impact in urban areas. More than half of the world's population is concentrated in cities today. By 2050, it'll be pushing towards 70%, according to UN data. The urban heat island effect, caused by traffic, air conditioning, heating, and great big thermal masses in buildings, makes cities hotter than the surrounding countryside by about 3 degrees Celsius on hot days and up to 12 degrees during the evenings. An estimated 130 billion square meters of new building construction is expected over the next 20 years. And once a building's been constructed, the amount of cooling required for human comfort is locked in. Improvements in the energy efficiency of the building envelope could reduce energy for cooling in hot climates by as much as 40%, according to the IEA. Making roof surfaces and pavements more reflective and increasing vegetation can make huge improvements towards offsetting the effects of urban heat islands too. On a typical sunny summer afternoon, a clean white roof that reflects 80% of sunlight will stay about 30 degrees Celsius cooler than a grey roof that only reflects 20% of the sunlight. It sounds so obvious, but it needs to be imprinted on the psyches of every architect and developer around the world. In fact, just as I was about to film this video, a new report landed in my inbox featuring research by a team at UCLA who replaced the titanium oxide in white paint with barite and PTFE or Teflon to produce a paint that reflects 98% of all incoming radiation, not just the visible white light. That's certainly a report we'll take a look at in more detail in a future episode. But just looking after existing buildings properly can make a big difference. Simple things like replacing AC filters monthly, cleaning coils, and even making sure that people don't block up the vents. Those blocked vents can increase energy use by over 25%. And if our huge supermarkets adopted the latest low energy, low GWP alternatives to their existing food chiller systems, they could improve their efficiency by up to 77% and achieve CO2 reductions of as much as 85%. All in all, the IEA estimates that on average, a well-designed city could cut down the energy it uses for heating and cooling by more than a quarter, with that figure rising significantly in the hotter countries. All these initiatives will require a combination of commercial investment and government policy on a similar scale to the Montreal Protocol. Governments are being urged to build national cooling action plans into the nationally determined contributions that they're obliged to present at COP26 in Glasgow in 2021. International regulations are urgently needed to stop inefficient cooling equipment getting forced onto developing countries and transitioning economies. And that means effective legally enforceable labelling systems enabling those countries to have the right information about a product before consenting to its import. The Biarritz Pledge for Fast Action on Efficient Cooling was launched at the August 2019 G7 Summit, where heads of state and governments committed themselves to backing cooling efficiency across their countries. The Cool Coalition is a global network connecting over 60 partners from the private sector, government, cities, international organisations, finance, academia and civil society. It supports a whole host of initiatives, including national cooling plans, as well as minimum energy performance standards, district cooling, green roofs and properly regulated cooling audits. The World Bank Sustainable Cooling Initiative is integrating efficient and climate-friendly cooling into its country engagements and investments. Digital technology allows utility companies to directly control cooling equipment in order to cap consumption during peak periods, usually in return for some financial reward for consumers. The International Energy Agency offers this conclusion. There are few certainties when it comes to energy, but one thing to be very confident about is that global demand for space cooling and the energy needed to provide it will continue to grow for decades to come. What is much less certain is exactly how quickly cooling-related energy demand will grow and how it will be met, in part because we don't know for sure how governments will act to influence underlying market trends. The consequences, notably for the environment, if governments do not act to curb energy demand for cooling, are likely to be severe. No doubt you've got views on this one, so dive down into the comments section below and leave your thoughts there. That's it for this week. We're taking a week's break next week, so the next programme will be coming your way on Sunday the 8th of November, by which time, of course, we should all know the outcome of what many people are calling the most important presidential election of our lifetime. Thanks to the channel supporters over at Patreon, who keep the lights on around here and also allow me to keep the content fully independent and ad-free. You can get involved with the channel if you want by visiting www.patreon.com/justhaveathink, where you can receive exclusive monthly news updates and have your say in content by taking part in our monthly polls. You can also hugely support the channel absolutely for free by subscribing and hitting that like button. And if you want to keep up to date with the latest video releases, then hit that little bell icon too. Dead easy to subscribe. You just need to click down there somewhere or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great couple of weeks and remember to just have a think. See you next time.